We are at the August 2nd meeting of the Technical Advisory Committee for Portsmouth. We'll start off with two items of old business, both of them request to postpone. First is the application of 505 Lafayette Road LLC owner and Lens Doctor applicant for property located at 605 Lafayette Road, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of the existing building and the construction of a proposed two-story office building with a footprint of 7,000 square feet, et cetera, with related paving, lighting, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said properties are property is shown on Assessor Map 229 as Lot 9 and lies within the Gateway District. This application was postponed at the July 12th, 2016 TAC meeting, and I believe their request is to postpone it to the next TAC meeting, scheduled TAC meeting. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The second postponement is the application of J&M Family Properties LLC owner and Dunkin' Donuts, care of JFS Management Company LLC applicant for property located at 802 Lafayette Road, requesting amended site plan approval to redevelop the parking lot for improved site and drive-through circulation, revised parking layout, new trash enclosure, drainage improvements, and stormwater management with related paving, lighting, et cetera. Said properties are shown on Assessor Map 244 as Lot 2 and lies within the Gateway District. This application was postponed at the July 12th, 2016 TAC meeting, and they have requested postpone it to the October TAC meeting. I'll accept a motion to postpone.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right, we're moving on to new business. The application of Seacoast Trust LLP owner and Stowgate, New Hampshire Construction LLC applicant for property located at 150 Route 1 Bypass, requesting site plan approval for the demolition of the existing building and the construction of a 246-foot by 85-foot three-story multifamily building with a footprint of 17,667 square feet and gross floor area of 53,000 square feet with related paving, lighting, utilities, etc. Said property is shown on Assessor Map 231 as Lot 58 and lies within the single residence B district. Who's here to speak to this petition?
I'll speak. My name is Corey Belden. I'm with Altus Engineering. Also here we have Tyler and Eric Cates from Stonegate and Sharon Summers from DTC. So we were just here last week to meet with the TAC workshop discussing the project. I'll try to do a quick summary. The proposal is for a 17,667 square foot footprint 30 unit residential building at 150 Route 1 bypass. The proposed project will reduce the impervious pavement in the area by over 14,000 square feet. That does not include an additional 780 feet that were we made as a revision of last week's workshop. The design is for the majority of the parking to be an underground garage. There's 44 underground parking spaces and only 11 external parking spaces. Is this
yeah, just make sure it's on the side there.
On the side of the thing is a switch.
Oh, there we go. On. Just going to the site plan. There we go. So, as we discussed at the TAC workshop last week, we were over on the allowable parking spaces. So, in that back parking lot, we've revised the parking to provide a central meeting island, and we removed six of the parking spaces to get the count down to the allowable 55 spaces as discussed. On site, we have three proposing three rain gardens. As I mentioned, we'll have a reduction of about close to 15,000 square feet impervious area. Three rain gardens that will treat the runoff from the, all the parking areas and the driveway access. This will discharge to a 36-inch culvert, existing culvert that crosses the bypass. We provide a drainage study which indicates that the peak flows for 2, 10, 25, 50-year storm events will all be reduced based on the, you know, reduction in impervious and the treatment for the rain gardens. So I'm going to go on to the letter that was submitted with these revised plans that addresses the comments that were that we discussed at last week's workshop. So the first, regarding utilities, there was a concern about the gas line. We confirmed that the existing gas line coming from Hillside Drive, there's a 4-inch line, and I have confirmation from Dave Bolio at Unitil. He said it's a high capacity line, and we actually only need about a 1 1/4-inch service for this building. So I don't think there's any concern that the gas line will be adequate for this this site. We revised the note on sheets, note 7, I believe that's the utility plan. As we discussed, we won't be able to read it from here, but possibly you were able to read it. We excluded the firearm panel connection to the city's master system and added the note 9 per city's requirements for the radio strength testing. So I think we addressed that comment. We had the sewer pump station. I provided Ray with the calculations for the pump station. So I don't know if there's any additional comments on that. We confirmed from the survey that the, you know, we're tying into the force main, the we're tying into the gravity line on Hillside Drive. There's the survey showed an existing 4-inch line going into that manhole, or the survey on site is a 3-inch line. So we're proposing a 3-inch line. We'll be connecting on site and not replacing any of the line through the easement. So we're just not sure where, if the connection into the manhole, if there's a, you know, goes from a 3-inch to a 4-inch, but if we need to, we'll connect and put a reducer in, and larger. On sheet C2, let's see, C2. this was, as previously discussed, we removed the six parking spaces by adding a third center island in the parking lot that provides 11 exterior spaces and 55 total spaces for the site, which is the 20% allowable. Regarding the landscaping, it was requested that we add the types of trees to remain, so we added those to both the demolition plan and the site plan. Essentially, there's some, those trees in the front of the property are oak trees and blue spruce, so those will be preserved for the site. The wetland notes, there was a error in there's a bad note on the plans that was depicting the areas for the two wetlands. Those were revised. As I indicated, the total wetland impact area actually decreased by 55 square feet as a result of that. So we anticipate going to Conservation Commission, I believe, August 8th. 10th. Okay. Item six on the letter, I'm going to try to hold off on that one for last. That's the concern about the groundwater. I think that's kind of the primary issue that we're going to need to discuss today. But some of the other issues, so we updated the green statement that was requested to include the, Peter, you had asked us to do that. It also included the parking calcs within that, so I revised those. And one of the items that we discussed at the workshop last week was the access along Middle Road. So we were sort of looking for maybe some more input from TAC on what the proposed, you know, what you would envision on there. I mean, we're proposing to widen the shoulder down to Spinney Road and to provide the pedestrian bicycle access through there. So
yeah, I mean, we can comment on that. I think, why don't you finish your presentation and we can comment on that.
Okay. Well, again, the I guess that's the presentation. I would like to discuss the groundwater issue. That's kind of a whole separate item that that I think we'd like to try to get everything else out of the way, hopefully, and then address that.
Okay, so just in response to the first comment about the proposed improvements on Middle Road in terms of connection, I think our preference would be that it be that we would like to see you do the improvement to a 6-foot wide shoulder, paved shoulder, and that would be a future bike lane that would connect to other facilities as we make improvements. But our fear with an 8-foot wide shared path is that it would eventually become a parking lane, and we would have it would be an enforcement issue. At this time, there is an existing sidewalk on the other side. The likelihood is that people will access that sidewalk as pedestrians anyway. We wouldn't want you to provide a crosswalk there, obviously, for safety reasons. But
right.
So I think our consensus is that a 6-foot wide shoulder would be sufficient down to Spinney Road, and then a crosswalk as you proposed at Spinney Road as well.
Okay.
Are we in agreement on that?
It's the far side of Spinney Road, right? It's not that close side, because the sidewalk goes on the other side of Spinney Road. It goes on the side where the building, the cul-de-sac right now.
Okay, so your crosswalk should connect, the crosswalk at the intersection of Spinney Road should connect to the existing or proposed sidewalk that's going to be on the far side of Spinney Road, closer to South Street?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. And we provide a tip down there as required.
Okay, so just make sure it's on the right side of that intersection.
Okay. Oh, do we have to go past the intersection and connect
exactly.
On that side?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's where the sidewalk is going to go.
Okay.
Okay. At this time, I guess, other comments or questions from TAC, or would you like to talk about your, why don't you go ahead and address the groundwater question?
Okay. Well, so, Dave brought up at the last meeting the concern for groundwater that we're going to be cutting into the groundwater table. We had provided a response and just indicated that, you know, typically, you know, groundwater foundation drains typically, you know, we I think it's industry practice that if you anticipate groundwater within your foundation, you put in foundation drains. Typically, they're low constant volume and don't really impact the peak flow. We provided some boring logs that were done in April of this year. And obviously, we anticipate groundwater flow elevations fluctuate throughout the year within, you know, rainstorms. Again, the based on our design for stormwater, we had a reduction of 14,000 square feet. We're providing treatment and reducing the peak flow, so we did not feel that, you know, we were adversely impacting the downstream conditions. So Dave responded back and said that the concern is really the baseline flow of the city, the city's concern. It's not the peak flow coming off, it's the volume. By providing the foundation drains, we're going down into the groundwater table, and they really want to make sure that what the volume leaving the site, Dave, correct me if I'm wrong. So he wants, if we had indicated that if we do want to keep the design as is, that we'll need to have, you know, a analysis of the groundwater system to support any, to support the design. So, and, you know, we definitely appreciate the city's concerns on groundwater. We understand that the site, you know, the groundwater does have an elevated groundwater table. And we will, you know, by installing the foundation drains, we'll be drawing that down as we, you know, per the design to keep the groundwater out of the foundation of the building. Certainly I'm not a hydrogeologist, so my understanding of groundwater is maybe limited. But as we discussed at the, Dave kind of mentioned at the last meeting, the site's sort of a bowl, and because we have a high groundwater table, what we'd be trying to do is essentially lower the rim of the bowl. One of the questions that we have is where does the existing groundwater go? Is it because we're going to need to, really the concern is, are we increasing what's going off site? So what's going off site today is really a question. You know, our thought was that what's coming in for groundwater would essentially be going out for groundwater after we lower the table. But we're going to hire a hydrogeologist to do a review of the site, and you know, we want to address the city's concerns and you know, hopefully we can. I don't think we'll have that issue obviously today. I don't think we'll resolve it, but what we would be hoping to get from TAC today is recommended approval of the project pending that we satisfy the city's concerns on the groundwater issue.
Okay. So I should have also said that the bike lane, I welcome comments on the bike lane. It's not a desert, it's not a goat. Until we decide that's what we want to do. So if there are other folks who have ideas on the proposed bike lane solution. And then any other comments or questions for the applicant at this point? Clarifications?
I have one small one. So I see the relocated generator. What is the fuel source for the generator?
Robert, just make sure that your microphone's pointed towards you when you speak.
Can you tell me what the fuel source of the generator is?
Propane. Natural gas.
And that's coming from?
Natural gas.
That's coming from the other side. So you should show that feed on the plan, but that's, so you're bringing it over. From Hillside Drive, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
All right, so you should show that on the drawing. So you're gonna come around the front of the building, I assume, and then?
Yeah, I guess we don't. Yeah, I believe we'll show that on a plan. I'm not sure if we'll come around the back through the parking area in the back or the front.
And then the only other comment is if it's, you'll just need containment that's enough for the, you know, the oil and the fluids in the contained in that particular generator.
Okay.
That's it.
Any other questions? Okay, so I'm going to open up the public hearing. Anybody wishing to speak to, for, or against this application, please come forward, state your name and address.
I'm good.
Okay. Seeing no one rise, I'm going to close the public hearing. All right, I would welcome either a motion for the purpose of discussion. or if nobody's ready to make a motion, I'd welcome discussion.
I still think the groundwater is going to be a big issue. We know about that, the study of that. Right now, they're lowering the grade at one of the rain gardens about six feet below the existing grade. Right now, it looks like it's well into the groundwater table on the site, going by the existing wetland areas that are there. There's one up to the north, partly on the site and off the site. There's an invert of a pipe leaving that at 29.4. So if the water gets at that point, it'll drain out. But if not, that's the elevation of that wetland. There really hasn't been any investigation of those wetlands. They also have as Corey mentioned, the perimeter drain around the building is proposed to go into the existing drainage system. And that also appears like it will, it would be in that water table and additionally lower the water table above the site. Those two sign features of this site appear that that's what will happen.
Okay.
So we're going to need a full analysis of that.
Right. So
of those proposed design elements to really, I'm not sure if you hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you.
So it's still a big concern that's going to add to the base flow and add quite a bit of flow off the site that doesn't come off today. And in addition to that, it could affect the viability of
the design.
The wetlands.
Yep.
Peter might talk to that too. I'm not sure if you've had any comments on that, but once you lower that water table, that could have a big effect on that.
Yeah, it sounds to me like this is enough an issue for DPW that making a provisional approval isn't really part of the consideration. Because it sounds like it really, in order for us as a TAC body to agree to recommend this, that we need a little more confirmation that this is feasible. So with that in mind, I guess I would welcome a motion to postpone. The applicant has already indicated they plan to hire a hydrogeologist. Do you think you could have a report back for the next TAC meeting in September? Or do we need to wait till October?
What's the next TAC meeting?
So, when's the next TAC?
It is
August 30.
August 30.
Right. August 30, and then and obviously you'd need to have plans, reports submitted well in advance of that so that folks could look at it.
Okay.
The following month, I think it's 27th.
One thing just to address Ray's concerns, and we did provide some boring logs, for the site. We've looked at the groundwater elevations there. They were done in April of this year, so we felt that they were, hopefully somewhat representative of a higher groundwater table. On the south side of the site, there are two borings. They hit water at 3 foot below ground. And some of the other site locations were 8.5 feet, 13.5 feet, and one of them, they hit a refusal. I believe it was at 8.5 or 13 feet. So, again, we understand the groundwater concerns. Looking at the borings, the soils on site, they're all very, very dense soils. So, lots of clays and silts in the soil. So there's not a lot of capacity for storage of water within those soils. We wouldn't expect a high volume from those, and groundwater in dense soils obviously migrates at a very, very slow pace. Again, I'm not a hydrogeologist, but I think our some of this information that we do have can support Again, if the board, if you're set on, you know, having that report from a hydrogeologist before you can make a decision, you can't make a decision to approve pending, you know, that we meet those concerns. This might be a moot point talking, but we are reducing flows, surface water flows. We're reducing peak flows. We're also reducing volume of flows by eliminating 15,000 square feet of impervious pavement. So
that's all good things. But we need a stamp report.
Yep.
That verifies all these things. The soils are very complex on that site because mm-hmm. a lot of the site is fill, because originally that was a much deeper site.
Mm-hmm.
So we really don't know what kind of vein you're going to be tapping into. We need to know that. We need to have a stamp. We need a stamp report, and we need that added to your drainage report, all stamped together, verifying with all certainty that you'll not be increasing the amount of flow leaks.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So I'm going to just close down the conversation on this right now. We're going to just make our motion, and I think at this point we'll just I would consider postponing a motion to postpone to the August meeting. If the applicant needs more time, just please let us know, and we can postpone it again, and we'll certainly consider additional postponements. So I'll accept a motion to postpone to the August meeting.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. All right. I will now accept a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
You're adjourned.
Take it easy.
Well, thank you.